Hello everyone, I'm very glad to be here in this community. And well, we'll talk today a bit about the cache, especially about the cache in Java. So let's go next, maybe a little something about me. So actually, I'm super happy to be here in this place today because a couple years ago, I started my journey with like programming in the team of people, like one floor above in InfoShare Academy. So it's like great to be here again. So I'm working as a senior software engineer at Capgemini, and if you want to like talk to me during the break, just pick the three random words from here, and definitely we'll make something out from it. Okay, agenda for today is quite simple. Let's start with the basic concepts and algorithms. Then we will go to the code. After this great presentation from before, I will not say it's like the pure live coding. It's more like semi-coding with everything prepared before. So, but well, I will show you some possibilities to use cache in Java. Then we'll go to the popular frameworks. We'll talk a bit about fine-tuning. And then, if we have enough time, we'll go to the alternatives to the in-memory approach, because basically what will be before will be about the in-memory things. Okay, so basic concept of cache and of course everybody knows cache because everybody from time to time needs to refresh cache in the web browser or IntelliJ because something is not working. So obviously when we are talking about the applications, we have different layers, and this is just another layer that will help us to preserve results gathered from some data sources, and it will help us to speed up the request processing, and maybe in some cases it will help to reduce the resource usage. And as you know, the green programming is a topic now, so maybe it could be some, you know, a little stone in this well whole concept. So well, just to show you like a simple scenario, we have no cache here. We have some kind of like external API. We'll get some requests. We are in most cases we have some kind of data source. So let's for this moment imagine that we have like this database that we will use to gather some data. We will send in the request, we are processing it, database is processing the request, giving us an answer, and okay, we will get more and more requests, more and more processing time, a lot of connections made to database, and a lot of traffic, higher latency usually. So let's introduce this another layer. Okay, first request is going straight to database because our layer for now is totally empty. But okay, we've got this processing, we've got the answer, and here is the catch. We will not just give the response and forget about it. We are saving it into the cache, and then every consecutive request will just check the value in cache and give the response straight from the cache. As you can see here, the amount of traffic between application and database is like a lot smaller, and as well as the processing time needed to get an answer. I came up with a couple of questions that I want to for you to, well, maybe remember them and follow up with the next slides. So when to populate cache? Does cache size matters? What about data consistency between cache and database? And one phrase that I think is important in this topic is knowing your data and like being aware which data you are processing, what data you are processing, what traffic you are expecting from your users. So everything is important and will help you with applying the proper functional cache. Okay, so thinking about the strategies of writing something to cache, we can think about, well, I think there are four of them here on slides. So the first one is write through strategy. So in this concept, we are everything we want to put to the database is going through the cache first. So in this approach, we will have this transaction. So to say that the operation was successful, we need to save data to cache and then to database. So it will take a little longer, but we can have the, well, the knowledge that the cache is always up to date. But if you think about reading, every request will go to the cache straightforward. Okay, next strategy would be write around strategy. So as you can see here, we are going not through the cache, but over it, just saving to the database and getting data with the first read. We will spend some amount of time to update our cache, and every other read will go from the cache. The first sentence here is important distinction between the first one and the second one. Here we are saving only the data that was demanded by the user, so we are not saving everything, making our cache flooded with data that maybe will not be used so frequent. Okay, next strategy is the write back strategy. Is basically the same as first one, but with the small difference. The difference is on the contract on the write success operation. So here we are only defining success when the data is saved to the cache, and we are not expecting it to be saved in the same moment to the database. It could enable us, for example, batch writing to the database. It could be, for example, cost optimal in some cloud solutions. We have quick read, quick write, but potential data inconsistency, because in this small moment between the writing to database, we have cache that have a slightly different state than database. Okay, having short answer about when to populate your cache. Let's think about the cache as a space, because if we are storing any kind of data, we need to think that this space that will hold this data will need definitely be restricted by some size. If we will use all memory of our unit, it will not be a good situation. So if we have any size restrictions, then we need to think what will happen if we have full capacity already used and new data will come. So there are two main, concepts that we should mention. So it's a eviction and expiration. So first, eviction is like algorithm and decision making which data should be deleted first from the cache when the cache is full and new data arrives. Expiration, on the other hand, is the situation when you put some data to the cache and then, by knowing your data, for example, if you have some kind of weather forecast application and you know that data center will give you information each hour, For example, you can decide, okay, the data from hour before is not longer useful for me. I should clean the cache from well, to make a room for the new data each hour. So about the eviction policies, we have a couple of them, and probably a couple more. But I wanted just to highlight the first one, as it's the most popular one across the well, vast amount of frameworks. It's least recently used. The algorithm behind this is can be showed as this. Like, we are putting one value to the cache, and for this example, let's imagine that this value is not acquired, so it's not used at any time. We are including another value, so you know this one is going to the tail of this structure, and we are having a full cache, and then we are getting new value. As you can see here, this 8 is then removed. So those two are based on the well, the usage of data of the keys. We can have also something related to frequency of the usage, or totally random algorithm, like, you know, random replacement or first in, first out, just to have the cache that is a living like living layer, that is not just filled once and then forget about adding anything else. Okay, having this in mind, let's switch to the first code example. Because, okay, when thinking about the implementation, okay, let me search where this code should go. Okay, it's not looking really great. Of course it is. Oh, come on. Okay, it shouldn't be like this. Okay, let's give it another chance. Okay. Okay, then let's turn off the presentation mode. Probably that could be it. And go to the cache. Oh, yeah, that's much better. Don't look for another pair of glasses. We are on the same page. Okay, so I've set up a little example. We have like one small repository. It's not connected to database, but instead I used zhippopotam.us, which is like public API that enables you to get the location data just by a request containing the postcode. Knowing your data, which data we'll use the postcode, 10 postcodes randomly generated, and okay, let's see what I came up with. It was like, you know, I just opened IntelliJ and said, okay, I've got a couple of minutes to implement my own version of cache. What should I do? Okay, so first things first, what data structure behind the simple cache I will use? Okay, simple key value store, hash map. Okay, we can define it with max size, so we can define the capacity of this cache. A couple of methods, which one of them is put. So, and we have this simple evict strategy, which is just random one. Okay, and then we have the main method. Let's go there. Maybe let's close all those places by this. Okay, I will run this because it will take a minute or so. Okay, we will have 300 requests, and they are going in the loop. We are generating just random postcodes, and using two methods: one that will use cache, and second one without cache. Okay, and here we've got the simplest possible implementation. So the first logic is just return something from the repository, and the second one is going through the cache. So we are checking, does our cache contains the data we want to use? If yes, go straight from the cache. If not, go to the repo and update the cache. So okay, it was run a bit ago. So okay, we've got super simple example, and we'll see what gain we could have after this whole execution will end, and I hope it will eventually. It's only 300 requests, but you know, my internet is really slow right now. Okay, as you can see here, for the without cache example, we have like almost 1.5 minutes, and with cache we have only 2 or maybe 3 seconds, right? So even such a simple approach will give us some benefit. Although there is a question regarding this, because do we have any thing that could bother us right now? I found couple of things. For example, we have super simple eviction policy here. To implement something more complicated, we probably will need to use different data structures inside of our cache. I don't know, like double linked lists, and manage this, you know, invent something from the scratch. There are concurrency issues. Probably we can solve them using different structures, more like thread safe ones, and expiration policy as well. Of course, we can have data structures also that can give us the possibility to adapt it for expiration policy. I think Wava have some like TTL maps that can be used here, but why bother anyway? We've got tools that were already invented, tested vastly in different projects. So what are popular frameworks? There are a bunch of them in the so you can look for many different frameworks. Probably the most popular ones are Memcached, Redis, Caffeine, probably something related to the cloud, so Amazon ElastiCache, Hazelcast as well. Okay, let's think what will happen if we will switch to the example that will use Caffeine, for example. I choose Caffeine just because I like the API of it. There is no other reasoning behind this. Just wanted to show you how simple setting the Caffeine is. Here we've got only one cache object. We are defining what data we will store there. We have a builder with, you know, a bunch of configurations that are enabled for us. So we've got maximum size. Let's say it's 10, because we know that we have 10 postcodes. Expire after write. We were talking about the 3 seconds in previous example. So 100 seconds, it's definitely too much. But well, our postcodes data will not change probably ever. So well, why to bother with expiring anyway? But okay, let's leave it for now. We can add some removal listener just to and record stats. So we have one additional thing that we have in this cache. We can monitor what is happening to the keys and to the data in our cache, which could be helpful or very helpful at the later stages of using cache. So well, let's start this. So here I will use only the example of using cache, because you know the previous one was already used. So as you can see here, we've got same as before, like around 3 seconds. We've got hit count of 290, and hit count, what does it mean? This parameter means that this request where trying to gather data from cache, and this cache gives a response saying, okay, I've got this data, just, you know, you can take it. Miscount, okay, we don't have this data in cache, so we are going to the repository, we are saving it to cache, and then it's available. So as you can see here, we've got size of cache of 10, we've got 10 postcodes, everything is as we expect. Let's go back. Okay, so to instead of writing something yourself, you've got framework which is already tested. We've got optimal performance, eviction policy applied, expire policy as well, as you see, so the TTLs, etc. So well, what we are lacking, for example, integration with Spring. Many popular frameworks are very well integrated into the Spring ecosystem. So I will show you one example of doing the same thing as before, but using Caffeine as well. As you can see here, we can configure such thing using the application properties or by defining some bins in the configuration file. So okay, let's go from this place again to that. Okay, so okay, we've got this application YAML file with configuration. So we've got maximum size of 10, expire after write 10 minutes, record stats enabled. So as you can see here, it's super simple. But let's go to the code, because I wanted to show how to exactly use the cache. So basically, it's just adding one annotation to the place you want to cache. So here we've got the connection to the repository. The repository is, you know, triggering the HTTP request, and we are caching this results. We can run it and let's see, we are opening Spring. Okay, here we had like 1000 requests, and as you can see here, we previously we had 300, now 1000, and the execution time is almost the same because the cache is super optimal. So it's super quick. Okay, let's go back to the presentation. Okay. Okay. Regarding Spring, Spring part, we have three annotation that we can use. So the cacheable, so the one that you already have seen. Another is cache put. So this one could be used to maintain the consistency between well, data source and the cache itself, because every time the method that is inserting some data to the, for example, to the repository, will also update the cache. So the difference here between cacheable and cache put is like here we are caching something once, and unless it's evicted or the time of leaving of this key will end, this will stay in the cache. Another one is just updated with the every put action. There's also evict. So we can imagine the situation that we have some kind of action that will trigger the eviction of the key. Okay, let's go to the fine tuning. By fine tuning, I mean what we could change to affect our cache. What could go wrong during the configuration of our setup? So, well, let's go to the code. Oh yeah, well, we can go with the Spring one. Okay, what we know, we have generated 10 different postcodes, right? Our cache size is super comfortable for them because its size is 10. Let's change it to 9 and see what will happen. So now our cache is a little bit smaller than the data that is trying to be saved there. Okay, I'm not sure if it's already loaded. Let me check. Oh, it should be. As you can see already, the execution time is a bit longer. So as you can see here, I changed only one parameter by just one one number, and we have previously we have eviction count of 0, now we have 91. That means that after filling the cache completely, we needed to delete something to insert something new. And this action, as we were using again and again and again generated data of 10 postcodes, it was done multiple times. So our execution time is slower, but well, it's much quicker than using no cache at all. So as you can see here, we can play a bit with the configuration. We can, for example, okay, leave the size of cache that is super comfortable, but expire after 1 second, maybe. Okay, let's run it. Boom, boom, boom. And it's also not as quick as in the first example. So by knowing your data, knowing your traffic, what I mean is that you can somehow predict how your cache should be configured. And if not predict, you can always check the stats of your cache and check what will happen, what is the eviction rate. If it's too much, maybe we should modify somehow the size of cache. Maybe we should, well, change the eviction strategy. And as you can see here, another small change and we are waiting a lot of time. Okay, let's go back to this presentation. And I see our time is really slow right now, so let's go quickly. Okay, we have different frameworks, and let's not go through all the things that could be compared, but I wanted to say one important thing maybe in decision making. Look at the state of the repository of such framework. As you can see here, sometimes you can have not a slight activity for 1 year or 1 year and a half. You can have a small community or big community like here. So that means that this framework will be more accurately, you know, adapt to the changes to the environment. Okay. Also, you definitely, if you will have the have to make decision of choosing the proper cache, probably you will look for benchmarks as well, and each framework probably will have its own benchmarks. But I found a little example. For example, Caffeine have its benchmark and it doesn't mention the cache2k. And you can ask why. Because on the cache2k benchmark, Caffeine is worse in some cases. So basically it's marketing. Of course, it's a lot of work done on those benchmarks. So of course, it's worth to check them. But always check different frameworks as well. Maybe another one will be more suited for your case. Well, there are different strategies to test it, various hit, miss, simulation, eviction policy tests. So, you know, you have some tool, you can test it by yourself as well by choosing the proper data and choosing proper, I don't know, test repository. So to test and simulate cases that are possible in your projects. What are alternatives to in-memory approach? There are some disk-based caching frameworks, so we are storing the cache on the disk side rather than the memory only. And with quick disks, SSD, it's not as bad as it probably was like in the old times. And you, well, definitely, well, are aware of it because you are using the invalid data cache in IntelliJ frequently, probably, and clear data. So it's something that is used. Also, there is like this very popular topic of distributed cache. And with distributed systems, with cloud solutions, the distributed cache also will definitely bring some value, and you can just read it here. And well, as a summary, I just wanted to say, know your data, try to define possible traffic, try different frameworks, maybe there will be not so much difference between them, but maybe the API will be more like user-friendly or you-friendly, let's say. So fine-tuning is a key. At some point, you can see that maybe your cache is slowing down, maybe you need to tweak something, but yeah. I think that's all. As you can see here, I'm strongly supporting any questions. You know, I even looked for this, you know, magical balls of smoke just to disappear right now. But before the questions, I just wanted to ask you a little question. I even have some reward if you will catch it. I'm using JShell and I'm asking it, what is the result of 1 + 1? I've got 3. Why is that? Binary? No. Anyone else? Okay, I will open different JShell. Because, of course, I did something to it, right? JShell. Okay, and here we've got the proper answer. Anyone? Yeah, that's the right answer. So basically, the cache is in different places, and Java as well is using cache to optimize different things. And integers from minus 127 to 128 are cached just to, you know, make processes quicker. And, you know, here's just a little hack that I just defined that 2 is a 3 in this cache. So if we will try to do the same thing on the, I don't know, integer 300, it will not work. Okay, that's all. So are there any questions?
Dziękujemy, Tomkowi. Czy są pytania? Ja podejdę z mikrofonem.
Thanks a lot for the presentation. Just simple question. For example, old legacy database have some business logic, for example, in triggers. And we change entity and map this entity into the, for example, table A. And we have trigger for table A, which update the trigger B, table B, which update. So do we have any techniques how to keep cache in consistency with database? In this case,
So the update is done like through the triggers of database, right?
Yeah. So we try we'll to not update be table aware. A, but we have a trigger for table A, which update table B. So it means that we think that changed only table A, but
I will not have the like proper answer for from the like Java perspective. I don't have it, but probably in the database itself there are some mechanisms as well that will support you. So I know that this answer is not maybe the best. That's
Czy jeszcze jakieś pytanko? O, tak, super.
Can we disable cache maybe from YAML, or how to do that?
Can we disable cache? Well, we by disabling cache you mean not using it at the application level. You'll just not use it, right? So what do you mean on the test purposes or? Well, that. Disable the cache at all. Well, I suppose I'm not sure if in this. I'm not sure if there is a flag like simple as that, but if you will add okay, I'm not sure if it's possible like straight from this, but maybe it will be easy to check in the configuration. Let's pretend we are using the bin configuration. Because, well, basically what you've seen in the YAML is like the same as defining the bin. So let's check if we have enabled something. Let's try it. Well, at least I didn't see something like this. So I don't really know. Probably maybe just I don't know. Sorry.
Okay, myślę, że to jest świetny temat do przedyskutowania na przerwie.
That's a great answer, yeah.
Janek będzie jeszcze pobliżu, więc można go złapać na przerwie i teraz mamy przerwę, która potrwa do 19:05. Zapraszam na napoje.